start with my own talk, which has a very pretentious title, Roots of Wood Culture and Wood Science. Personally, I'm a wood anatomist, and my knowledge of wood culture is that of an interested amateur. So I will just be fairly anecdotal when I talk about wood culture. I'm a wood scientist, so I hope my remarks there are a bit less amateurish, but it is such a wide field that I will only be able to give you a very general idea, and I've already seen in the program that many of you will go much more in depth in this very on the topics I will only touch on. Now, when you hear the title Roots of Wood Culture, you may think literally about roots of trees, and indeed they are very interesting. As you see in this slide, on the right hand side you see root wood, and on the left hand side you see stem wood of an elm tree, the same elm tree. But I'm not going to, this is very, very interesting for tree biologists, and I could talk about that for hours, but that's not the subject of my talk. Instead, I will address some metaphorical roots of wood culture, and as I already said, rather anecdotal, not comprehensive. I will discuss with you the dawn of wood science. I will briefly discuss the role that wood collections have played in the development of wood science, and then I will just give some personal examples of wood culture research, and wind up with some thoughts on wood science and how it can support some sustainable future for this planet. So the oldest signs of interaction between wood and man, which is a very broad definition of what wood culture is about, the use of wood by man for whatever purpose, comes from the Holy Land. This piece of charcoal of olive was found in Galilee. It is 790,000 years old, and the authors, Goren Imbarberka and Feibel, claim that they have arguments that this charcoal comes from a man-made fire, not from a wildfire caused by lightning. They've also found a wooden plank of a willow where they claim to have seen signs of tooling by man. People living in this area, roaming the plains and the hills of Galilee, were hand axe culture, so with the hand axes, they're reported to have worked this wooden plank. And they also found an oak log, which they say must have been polished by man. Now this is very controversial, because you can easily imagine that people can argue for ages whether the charcoal is from the wildfire or from a hearth. And you can also imagine that a polished oak log may have gotten its polished appearance by rowing over on the bottom of the stream or the river or something like that. I will drink a sip of water every now and then because I have a bad throat. The slightly less old throne appears from Germany, which you can see here. 400,000 and 270,000 years old, respectively, are less controversial and clear signs that man used wooden tools in his hunting activities. Much, much more recently, we have a much more sophisticated array of wood used by the Uzi Iceland, found in the north of Italy, in the Alps, where the longbow of this man was made of Texas yew, the copper axe had a yew handle, and the arrows had viburnum and corners of shafts. So we already have a wide selection of wood uses. From Austria, we have a very ancient location, Hallstatt, in the village of Hallstatt, where in an old mine, there's a preserved wooden staircase of spruce, altogether 3,400 years old now, more or less. And that staircase looks as though you could still safely walk down there. It's just as safe as the staircases on the Queen Mary. In that context, a whole range of wooden objects has been found, as you can see here. Incidentally, these slides are borrowed from Michael Grabner from Vienna, a very faithful attendant of World Wood Day, who can't be with us this year, who sends you his greetings. But you see that this old European culture really had a very broad range of wood uses and beautiful woodworking skills. Paying a lot of attention to the far right and left hand side two cursors of our matches. This is become as a bit of a surprise. This is a modern boomerang. I couldn't find any picture of very ancient boomerangs, but I think boomerangs are a beautiful object to illustrate the ancient use of wood culture by many different peoples. He created boomerangs with Australian Aboriginals, but we know they use them to great effect in their hunting, and they can return. The returning aspect of a boomerang is not what's really so important for them, is the aerodynamics with which they can hit small animals in the hunt. Boomerangs have already been depicted in rock art 50,000 years before present. They have found in peatbogs in Australia with an age, respectable age, of 10,000 years old. But I've been told by an American archaeologist, the Indians of Florida also use boomerangs, and they have been found in a preserved context 10,000 years old. Now, the most surprising boomerangs I came across was when as a tourist, I went to the Cairo Museum, and in all the displays of Tutankhamun's tomb, there was this huge collection of boomerangs, sloppily displayed, as so many of these treasures of the Tutankhamun tomb, and those were at least 3,000 years old. From Poland, we know boomerangs which are 20,000 years old. These were not made of wood, but of the tusks of mammoths. So here, this boomerang technology has, in my opinion, evolved at least four times independently. I then think the Faroes sailed to Australia to get inspired by the Aboriginals. The Polish people may have interacted with ancient Egyptian, though that doesn't. It must be total independent evolution of the boomerang technology. And it's nice to think at this World Wood Day that we must be careful with boomerangs, otherwise they come right back into our faces. Here in India, or in America, I want to pay tribute, of course, to the very rich wood culture of the native population here, but I don't know a thing about it, so I just borrowed from the internet this lovely bow of live oak from Texas, 3,000 years before present, beautiful in its simplicity, and a very special use of, or consideration of roots of wood culture is the utilization of ancient petrified wood in human culture. This is a slide I borrowed from Elizabeth Wheeler. Elizabeth Wheeler also sent you her warmest greetings But this, these houses, Agate House, is from about 1150, 1300 after Christ, but the stones are petrified wood. So you have roots of culture here in a double sense, because roots, fossil woods, you can consider as the precursor of our modern woods, and the evolutionary terms, they are the roots of our modern flora, and then the utilization by ancient cultures of that petrified wood is another type of rooting. And again, in Egypt, we find some remarkable examples of the use of petrified wood. In the desert, a whole road where which is partly paved by fossilized, petrified wood logs. And in the Cairo Museum, they hold this lovely statuette of a pharaoh carved in petrified palm wood, the palm oxen. At many meetings of this organization, we have reflected on the very rich wood culture of China, and this just summarizes a few early, you could say, Guinness Book of Records, earliest signs of use of wood in timber frame housing, in coffins, in paper making, and in matchmaking in China. So this concludes my anecdotal overview of first uses of wood, and I think we can safely conclude that wood use is, of course, as old as mankind, especially in using wood for fuel, that the link between man and wood has been a close one ever since Adam and Eve, probably. Now, the use of wood requires understanding of wood and its properties. And of course, these early people, these prehistoric people, had that knowledge, but they didn't write anything down. The first person to really assemble a wood knowledge in a systematic way was allegedly Theophrastus of Lesbos. Lesbos, the island which we now sadly know as the island where refugees trying to enter Europe from Turkey get stuck and are kept in almost concentration camp-like conditions. Shame upon my continent of Europe, that is really very bad. But anyway, in happier times, Theophrastus was walking around on that island. He knew that fossilized tree, and he, throughout his career, he published extensively on plants, on stones, on characters, on physics, morality, ethics, logic. He was a pupil of Plato and continued his tradition of the peripatetic school that was walking around with his students while discussing the wonders of nature, the world, and philosophy. Please come in. And he was a contemporary of Alexander the Great. And he had a lot of things to say and write about timber. He recognized that slow growth was related to dense wood. At breakfast, I was just told that we have some Indian wood workers here who work the slowest and hardest ironwood here from the Sonora Desert. So that relationship of slow growth and hard wood is pretty global, I think. Theophrastus recognized hardwood properties and color of different species. He discussed decay resistance of different species in a very meaningful way. And he described the properties and uses of many species. He recognized growth layers. He described them as onion layers. And he realized that they were formed every year, so that he could estimate tree ages. which of course was in that day and age quite revolutionary. He was also interested in the effects that the environment and provenance could have on wood quality. In his days, timber from Corsica was highly preferred to the miserable trees they still could get out of Greece. You know, it's perhaps a side remark. If you study ancient civilizations, their rise and fall very often coincides with the rise and fall of their timber supply. And the Greeks already had to go to Corsica for good timber, and he reflected why was the timber of Corsica so much better than the timber of Greece? Was it the climate, the soil, or the silvicultural measures they already used in these days to improve the wood quality? So I have no hesitation to proclaim Theophrastus, who is already proclaimed as the father of botany in general, but also as the father of tree ecology in relation to wood properties. And his work was not easily forgotten, because a few centuries after his death, Pliny, the great Roman philosopher and scientist, brought all Theophrastus's work together in his Natural History encyclopedic works. So throughout the Middle Ages, Theophrastus's thoughts were about the only things that mattered in the timber science in Europe. It would take the Italian Renaissance and its offshoots in northwestern European countries to bring a real revolution in wood science through the discovery and development of the microscope. First one was the Englishman Robert Hooke, who published his Micrographia, or Micrographia, in 1665, and included not just butterfly wings and the house flea and that sort of things, beautifully enlarged, but also pictures of fossil wood, enlarged charcoal and cork cells. Great founders of wood anatomy, comparative wood anatomy, as seen down the microscope for Nehemiah Grew and Marcello Malpighi in London and Italy, respectively. These people wrote really impressive books on plant anatomy, and with important chapters specifically devoted to wood anatomy. But my hero is, and I'm a chauvinist, is my fellow countryman Antonio van Leeuwenhoek, contemporary of these three other people from England and Italy, but the person who kept in touch with these three, because they were all fellows of the Royal Society that just had been founded in 1660, I believe, in London. And these people wrote the letters to each other, and although they didn't have airmail, the mail arrived from Delft to London and was answered more quickly than it is nowadays with a express delivery stamp on the envelope. You know, the ships just sailed to and fro and carried these letters. Anyway, Antonio van Leeuwenhoek is better known for his discovery of sperm cells, of bacteria, of blood cells, etc., etc. But he also was a very keen student of wood structure. Here we see his portrayal of an ash twig, Fraxinus excelsior, and I don't have a pointer, but these small drawings on the side show that he was aware of pitting in vessels and perforations in vessel elements. Really very detailed and excellent. These are his drawings of, on the left-hand side, slow-grown oak, on the right-hand side, fast-grown oak. And he was aware that growth rate in oak, in this case, meant that the slow-grown oak was of highly inferior quality to the fast-growing oak because of the high porosity of the closely spaced growth rings, and that's why he imagined, as he wrote to the Royal Society, that oak coming from the Netherlands, where oaks didn't grow that fast, was of inferior quality than the oak from France for the production of wine barrels. And here we see modern pictures of a fast-grown and slow-grown oak made by my student who studied the effects of acid rain on growth rates in oak. And you see how well these light microscopic photographic images match the pictures of Van Leeuwenhoek. Here we see oak as seen through the microscopes by Grew on the left, Bernard-Picqué in the middle, and Leeuwenhoek on the right. And I don't think I need to convince you that my fellow countryman wins this contest of the best portrayal. But if you look very, very carefully, and if you are wood anatomist, you see that this slipshod Italian drawing by Malpighi contains a very, very interesting detail overlooked by the other people. Is there anyone in this audience who understands what I mean? I will come down. Tylosis, wonderful, yes. He saw the Tylosis, and so he recognized a very important principle of the living tree in hardwood formation, of closing down the vessels and closing off any entry for decaying organisms into the hardwood. So, all this comparative microscopy of wood, which was partly applied science but very much also curiosity driven, comparative amateurish, these people, these pure scientists called themselves amateurs. Amateur was not the word what we think now of these people are not professional, but good amateurs were gentlemen scientists who really looked for the bottom, for the causes of things, etc. These gentlemen amateurs needed wood collections for their comparative research. And wood collections had their origin in the natural curiosity cabinets of the rich and the wealthy, which they just assembled for fun. And the, perhaps one of the most famous natural curiosity cabinets was made by my fellow countryman Albert Sieber of Amsterdam, who had such a, he was an apothecary, but he had such a famous cabinet of curiosities with snakes and, but also woods, that Tsar Peter the Great, when he was in Amsterdam for his internship to learn shipbuilding, bought the whole cabinet of Sieber and brought it with him to St. Petersburg, or Leningrad, not Leningrad, that was a much, much later name. But Sieber, in 2 years' time, had reassembled a new cabinet through his contacts with the incoming fleets from the East and West Indies in Amsterdam. You may think, why would an apothecary have a wood collection? That was not so strange, because in those days, many wood species were used for medicinal purposes, extracts, and there were even wood species of which cups were made, and you only had to put hot water in it and drink it, and you had tea with the extract of the secondary metabolites from the wood. The real first wood collection, which was just a wood collection I know of, was kept by the king of Poland and Saxony in his palace in Dresden, Germany. And the king had bought it again from a schoolmaster who had assembled about 350 wood species, and that collection had been catalogued in 1729 anonymously by a man calling himself Lignophilius. Lignophilius, so he who loves wood. Wonderful. And it would take a fellow countryman, again, a medical doctor, Dr. Houghton, and if you translate the word Houghton into English, that is literally translated timber garden or timber yard. Can you think of such a coincidence? A medical doctor called Timber Yard who has as a hobby the collection of timbers. Anyway, this man spent a good day of his old elder years in having all these woods drawn and catalogued in a wonderful book called Houtkunde, that literally translated wood science, but with, for each timber, multi-entry names in Dutch, English, French, German, and Latin. So that book really was true first global wood academic. And I'll just show you one page here with some famous timbers like Indian rosewood, boxwood of various types, and black ebony on the right-hand side below. The real wood collection, unfortunately, is not preserved, but the drawings and their paintings is really quite beautiful, Now, these collectors were so fanatic about enlarging their collection, and because they were partly from the medical profession, they also pressed non-woody plants into these little wood samples, even if it was gentian root, ginger, rhizomes, or cyclamen tubers. So that's a bit of a broadening of the idea of wood collections. A very narrow time frame between about 1780 and 1810 in Austria, Germany, and Scandinavia, some people turned wood collections into a very important educational tool by making so-called wood libraries, encyclopedias, that for each species they had a book-shaped box with on the outside bark from that particular tree species, and inside small wood samples, leaves, fruits, flowers, dried. A wonderful way to assemble a representation of nature around us. There have been interesting interpretations of why only in that period people were doing this, and why only in this romantic part of Europe, while Schubert and Beethoven were composing their pastorale symphonies, and someone else was putting some nice leaves in these boxes. An absolutely unique way of collecting wood was pioneered in Japan in 1825, around 1825. The great Japanese scientist Mogami Tokunai collected wood samples from trees in Hokkaido, then called Yezo. But on the wood samples, beautifully polished, he painted the leaves of the trees from which these things were collected. This technique is mirrored in much rougher laser printed wood from yellow poplar here from the United States. But I think you agree that the Japanese wood samples, of which you've seen 9 specimens here, is much nicer. Our institute very proudly owns this wood collection, and as a young student, I was privileged to rediscover it. We had it in our junior demonstration room for the plant anatomy practicals, and I thought it was very nice, and nobody knew what the provenance of these woods were, and in a bad moment, I even sort of bringing them home and using them for decoration until we found out this very important
provenance of these woods coming from Ogami Dokonai and five great Japanologists from Seaboard to the Netherlands. I think that Professor Takao Ito would really be appalled if I would have stolen those wood samples and used them for private use. Most wood samples are not so decorative, they're just standard-sized, cut and standard-sized to fit certain drawers, or are just irregular lumps of woods. Our institute has a collection of about 130,000 wood specimens. With that number, we have the largest wood collection in the world. We've beaten the Forest Products Lab in Madison, Wisconsin, which only has 110,000 wood samples. But there's no glory in that. We are just so big, because all the small wood samples, or small wood collections in the Netherlands, were in dire straits, as they are worldwide. Maintaining a wood collection for a scientific institution costs a lot of money and doesn't bring in a lot of revenue in terms of modern research projects. So wood collections are suffering all over the world, and we have to fight to preserve them and give justice. Well, medicine can overtake us any moment, the moment of the Field Museum in Chicago and the Smithsonian Institution in Washington decides to get their wood collections out of storage and dump them in medicine, where just like in London, they just have one wood anatomist to look after it. So there are too many wood samples and too few people to study them. Here we see some possible uses of wood collections and the red marked subject wood identification, archaeology, wood and arts and crafts, dendrochronology, climate reconstruction, education, history, etc. They are all relevant to wood culture. So, wood collections as a primitive base for wood science. Why and why should we bother so much about wood science? Well, just to refresh your memory, wood is the most important reusable material for construction, furniture, pulp, paper, and energy. Wood was and is of great cultural and societal importance. Wood is of vital importance for the functioning of big land plants, and wood is an archive of climate signals for living in their trees and timber. It's a storage tissue for the greenhouse gas CO2 and a rich source of chemicals and nanostructures, and as this World Wood Foundation, the International Wood Culture Society claims, wood is good when and if sustainably harvested and timely replanted after harvesting. To wind up just a few examples of research and wood culture, wood research of course would fill an entire conference easily. I will just mention some examples of non-destructive wood identification for restoration projects and wood and climate change. My favorite example of wood culture research comes from Australia, where my colleagues Healy et al. Studied the Riley cabinet. The Riley cabinet dates from about 1820 and was made by convicted cabinet makers from London. Criminal cabinet makers who had been expelled to the penal colony of Australia by His Majesty's government and continued there to use their skills to make lovely furniture. But the question was, did these criminal cabinet makers use traditional wood species they had access to in London and which they could have gotten in Australia from leftover wood on ships, etc.? Or did they use the local timber species immediately, which were not, had not been used by Western cabinet makers at all? So all these different bars were sampled and studied, and they turned out, as you see in the right hand side, they turned out to be all native woods from New South Wales, from the forests of New South Wales. To do that, they couldn't destroy the cabinet, of course, so they used veterinary syringe by which they took little cores from wood parts which were out of sight in the cabinet and then put under a scanning electron microscope. I thought that was an absolutely lovely way to apply wood anatomy and wood identification to a wood cultural question. The study and restoration of very subtle inlay work on marquetry like these museum pieces does not allow even the use of veterinary syringe to take wood samples. So here we have to use reflected incident light microscopy to try and identify the wood components, which is essential if you want to restore things for some purpose or another. And Flavio Ruffinato, an Italian wood anatomist, who's also worked in the United States for a while, has pioneered new methods with this incident light, which are very promising, as you see here, in transverse surfaces and here in longitudinal surfaces. So we can do a lot, especially in wood identification, especially thanks to the wonderful, wonderful computer database Inside Wood, curated and pioneered by Elizabeth Wheeler from Raleigh, North Carolina, where you can identify now 8,000 species, not only timber trees, but also shrubs and lianas, on the basis of their microscopic wood structure. And this database is really very, very widely used. At some days or weeks, the Vatican Museum is the most frequent user, and I always think that probably they're secretly studying all the relics from the cross and finding that there are thousands of wood species in these relics distributed in churches worldwide. It's not a punishment to study wood for wood identification because the structures are just so bloody beautiful, as this slide just shows. New approaches complementary to microscopic wood identification involve DNA analysis, tomography, machine vision, infrared mass spectroscopy, densitometry, and new methods in charcoal analysis. So science continues, and we use the most modern tools to answer questions, not just for museum purposes, but very seriously in combating illegal logging and illegal timber trade, because so many valuable tree species have become commercially extinct, just like the rhino horn, they're being hunted and harvested, and that has to be stopped, and to use to bring the criminals to justice, one really, and to stand up with an identification in a court of justice, then you sometimes have to bring all these methodologies into play, because otherwise the lawyer for the defense will always win. How am I doing? Okay, very briefly, if we want to understand wood for all its uses, it's always very good to go back to the living tree. Why is it possible that a living tree like this Brisbane pine, about 5,000 years old, is still upstanding there, with carrying its huge weight, transporting water from this rocky soil to its transpiring needles, and also having some sort of mechanism which has been active over the last 5,000 years to prevent it from decaying, from insect attack, from microbial and fungal attack, etc., etc. The answer to that question is simply because plants have invented wood to give both mechanical strength, to give a low resistance pathway for water conduction, and to have decay resistance. again material for our conference. But I'm very proud of these freehand sections which I made here in California at Berkeley on the kitchen sink of Rudi Schmidt. And here you see in light microscopy the wood structure of this bristlecone pine, which explains it all if I would have had more time. Here we see scanning electron micrographs of three totally different types of wood structures, all with different strategies for plants, trees, for survival and adaptation to their environments, but all, as you can easily imagine, with very different properties for a woodworker and for construction purposes and for paper making, etc., etc. One of the simplest features you can deduct from wood structure are growth rings and growth ring width, at least if the trees are from a subtropical or temperate region. Here you see the methodology explained in the old slide by Hamburg colleagues, who I thank dearly. But here we see an application of growth ring width to reconstruct mean annual temperatures worldwide. And you can see that around just before the year 2000, there was a huge increase in, and there's an ongoing increase in mean annual temperature, which we now notice in the melting of the Arctic ice, etc., etc. And how the hell can Donald Trump deny climate change if the tree rings tell him it is there? We have to see the trees from the wood and the wood from the trees, but trees, again, are wonderful components of forests, and forests must be our answer to combat climate change simply because they have this wonderful ability to store the greenhouse gas. And of course, in a natural situation when everything circulates, recycles, then it's a net neutral carbon ecosystem. But if we, as wood culture people, harvest on a sustainable manner the wood from these trees and put them in buildings, etc., etc., and other constructions, then we can really make a difference and lower the CO2 level in the atmosphere rather than increase it. Unfortunately, at present, we are still net contributors to CO2 in our atmosphere, as you see from these burning forests. And so we only have 4 billion hectares of forests left in this world, and deforestation continues. Fuel wood and round wood construction has stabilized in the last decades on around 0.5 cubic meter per head, but that shouldn't stop us worrying, because the world population doubles every 45 years, so our true wood hunger surpasses the capacity of, with our population growth, it surpasses the capacity of the current forests, so we need many, many more forests. This goes too quickly to build wooden structures like this. And then I can come to the conclusion that, as I said, rise and fall of ancient civilizations is often correlated with timber supplies from healthy forests versus deforestation. Now we need more forests and timber to store the greenhouse gas CO2 and save the planet and human civilization as a whole. But not just forest protection is the answer. The right utilization of timber is essential, an essential component. So wood culture people continue to use wood freely, but sustainably. Thank you very much.